Let's get to your Boston Celtics. Oh, go ahead. Did you want to say something else?
Oh, no. We can get to the Celtics because the word on the street was that you canceled the show last Tuesday to avoid talking about the Celtics sweep getting to the finals. Knew you hated my guys that much, but yeah. So Jayson Tatum and Jaylen Brown are back in their second finals in 3 years, and Jaylen Brown is fresh off of his Eastern Conference MVP. It was the same way the last time, I believe, when they played the Warriors in the finals. But with that said, does Tatum need to be the alpha in order for the Celtics to succeed?
No. So that, I don't think Tatum has to be the best player for the Celtics to win the title.
Either.
I don't think the Celtics are going to win the title. And the obvious, clearest way for them to do it is for Tatum to jump a level in the finals. I don't think that's realistic. I think he can play better than he played in those finals against Golden State. But I think the Celtics are built, and tell me if you agree, DeMonte, this is your team. In a way, they are built similarly to, not defensively the same, the 04 Pistons. You don't remember that team, so let me give a little context. The 04 Pistons had, but on any given night, you did not know who their best player was going to be. Like, their best players were Chauncey Billups and Rasheed Wallace. But Tayshaun Prince could be their best guy on a night. Rip Hamilton could be their best guy on a night. Ben Wallace was defense only. I think the Celtics are built in a way that on any given night, Derek White can go off. Jaylen, obviously, can be the best player on multiple nights. Tatum can be the best player. We forget it, but Kristaps, we'll see. It's what he had looked like. I don't think there's going to be many nights Drew is the best player. He's a better offensive player, obviously, than Ben Wallace was, but he's going to be focused more defensively. So I don't look at the Celtics, DeMonte, as a team that, man, if Tatum doesn't go toe-to-toe with Luka, they can't survive. Right. And I think that's good for them because I don't think Tatum can go toe-to-toe with Luka. But that's no shame. There might not be anyone alive that can go toe-to-toe with Luka. And, well, go ahead. You go.
Yeah, so, I mean, we'll just Tatum hasn't really had... I do think that he's kind of owning this thing of, like, he doesn't need to ball out or go crazy or do the Josh Allen thing in order for them to win games. And I think that he's going to do what it is that's necessary. And I just don't think that they've seen that opponent. Obviously, the teams that they've faced to get to this finals run, their best player has been injured each time. I don't think that any of these games have called for Jayson Tatum's A+. So I do think we'll see a different version in these finals. But
no, yeah. And he, by the way, he deserves credit. He did have an A+ game in game 3. I think he had 36 points, 10 rebounds, 8 assists, and 0 turnovers. He was spectacular. That was one of the 5 or 6 best games, playoff games he's ever played. He was great in that game. The weird thing about Tatum is the last 2 years in the postseason, he's 31% from 3 on 8 threes a game. He takes threes and confidently and at the volume of a guy who's 37%. Like, you know what I mean? Like, it is a huge part of his arsenal, and it just hasn't been the case. And so there are times where I think it can be frustrating because he's 6'9.5". He's built
up. Out of the bucket. You know,
when he came into the league, he was skinny. He is now super strong. It feels like he could be more impactful slashing than he allows himself to be. It does feel like he settles a little too often.
Yes, he probably takes now, like 3 more shots than he should have just taken to go to the rim a game. I see it
a lot.
That's
right.
Like, he'll stop and do like a little jumper, and you could just power through.
And here's the thing on that. So that is, sometimes guys do that. Because I remember, this is like one of my earliest Fox memories. I remember watching a Cavs playoff game at some restaurant in Santa Monica with Charlie, the guy who's probably, you know, one of the two people most responsible for my entire career at Fox, and it's still my boss to this day, runs the network now. And LeBron on back-to-back plays, had driven to the basket and scored. This was the 2016 playoffs. Yeah, it would have been 2016 playoffs. Maybe 2017. Doesn't matter. And Charlie turns to me and says, see, why doesn't he do that every play? And me, exasperated, turned to him and said, because it's god dog exhausting. Because even LeBron at that level, you know, and so if people would get frustrated when LeBron would settle for jumpers, but the answer is nobody has 30 drives to the basket in them a game. What's uniquely frustrating about Tatum
LeBron
is
LeBron also has to carry a team.
You know, correct. More acceptable right. For him and
to be tired.
Right. And but the other thing is LeBron was not shooting 8 threes a game. You know, right. He was shooting, at that point, he was shooting 5. And so it just, like, 3 is the exact right number. It just feels like there's 3 or 4 times a game that Tatum settles when he doesn't need to. Now, where I do think that, where if you're a Celtics fan, where you have to be the most nervous is this. At the end of games, the Mavs know exactly what they're doing. 1 out of 3 possessions, they are going to let Kyrie try to cook someone. 2 out of 3, they are going to say, Luka, go do it. If you get a favorable matchup, get them on your hip, do your little old man move in the lane or a step back or throw a lob. And the lob numbers, have you seen the lob stats these playoffs? This is the craziest thing ever.
What was that, 20?
No, so going in, this is as of game, prior to game 4. So these are, so the team with the third most alley-oops, successful alley-oops, these playoffs, was the Celtics at 8. The team with the second most was the Thunder at 9. And the team with the most, so second most was 9. The team with the most was the Mavs with 48. 48 successful alley-oops this postseason going into game 4. Luka had 28 by himself. Like, such a huge part of their offense has been Luka's, you know, Derek Lively is shooting 100% from the field in the conference finals. Because every single one of them is just a dunk. That. Right, and that's also why they need Kristaps back. You know what I mean? It's also why they need Kristaps back. But my point is, at the end of games, the Mavs know exactly what they want to do. And the Celtics, this is the downside to the Jaylen Brown, Jayson Tatum, Batman, Robin, Robin, Batman situation. It is not clear, crystal clear, at the end of games, who they're going to. That, you know what I mean? That is the one downside to it. Now, I don't buy into, there's this weird narrative going on, like, does it matter that Jaylen Brown won conference finals MVP? Was Tatum not happy enough of it? All that to me is BS. Those two guys are clearly good friends. They work really well together. They have had consistent A-minus success together. The question is, can they finally have an A+?
Hey, thanks for watching. Hit the subscribe button to get more from the show and make sure to click the bell to get notified every time new content drops. Check out full episodes of What's Right wherever you get your podcasts, or just click the link in the description below.